U.S. military might and the NATO alliance stood together against the Soviet Union through the Cold War, and then its troops fought together on the battlefields of Afghanistan and worked together to secure the peace in other parts of the world in the years that followed. But is NATO still relevant? What are the threats facing the U.S. and its allies today? And will there be another world war in our lifetimes? Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. Our guest on the program can take us inside those issues in a way that few people can. Retired four-star Admiral James Stavridis is the former Supreme Allied Commander of NATO and the head of U.S. Southern Command. He is the author of a new book, 2034, a novel of the next world war. Admiral, thanks for joining us, sir. Your book is my kind of book, a global thriller with real-life scenarios that will make you think. So thank you, sir.
Thanks for having me on, Frank. And yeah, the novel is very character-driven. There's certainly plenty of technology and plenty of geopolitics, but in the end, it's the story of a handful of characters who face a world war. And it's not apocalyptic. The world doesn't end. I'm not going to give you any more spoilers. But I think it works as a cautionary tale as we look ahead to the year 2034. We've got to avoid sleepwalking into a war with China.
Yes, sir. Let's talk about some of these real life events and potential threats to the international stability and to the U.S. right now. I want to, before we get to China, start with Afghanistan, America's longest war, coming on 20 years now. The deal that called for all U.S. troops to be withdrawn by May of this year, now uncertain. Some 2,500 U.S. troops remain in country. You oversaw operations in Afghanistan for a period of time. And I'll just ask you, should we still be there?
Yeah, I commanded that mission for four long years, 2009 to 2013. And I would argue that we should still be there. But here's a really important point, Frank. When I commanded that mission, I had 150,000 U.S. and allied troops working for me. Today, there's only 2,500 U.S. troops left. There's about 6,000 allied troops left. So we've gone down from 150,000 troops down to less than 10,000, of whom only 2,500 are from the U.S. What does that get us? It allows us to continue to ensure that there is no terrorist activity that can strike the United States. That's why we went there in the first place. With that small a military footprint, I would argue stay, continue to keep pressure on the Taliban. We're at the negotiating table. You know, sports analogy here, we're at the 5-yard line with this thing. Now is not the time to just walk away.
We have spent as a nation $193 billion in Afghanistan on the war side, 2,200 plus American lives lost, 10 times as many in terms of wounded Americans, countless Americans who will have emotional scars for the decades to come. This is an unfair question, but can you say to the American people that we won this war?
The short answer is not yet. But I would say we could argue that we will be successful if we can maintain a democracy, if we continue to have access and engagement with Afghanistan, which is strategically very important where it is located geographically, and above all, if we achieve our fundamental objective. Again, why did we go there? We went there because terrorists came from Afghanistan and knocked down the World Trade Towers, flew a plane into the Pentagon. By the way, I was in the Pentagon, on the side of the Pentagon, and literally watched the airplane hit about 150 yards to my right. So I've got a lot of skin in this game, so to speak. And I would say to any American, these have been high, high costs. But we went there for a reason. It was to ensure terrorism could not return from an ungoverned space like that it was, and that we can still succeed to avoid turning it back over to Al-Qaeda, to the Islamic State, and others.
Let's move to another country, Russia, and Vladimir Putin. Russia interfered in our elections, has engaged in the illegal annexation of Crimea. There is a consensus that Vladimir Putin poisons political rivals like Alexei Navalny, assassinates former intelligence agents who've defected to the West. The Cold War is over. But is Russia still a threat to the U.S.?
Absolutely, Russia is still a threat to the U.S. and a threat to their neighbors. Don't forget, in your shopping list of recent Vladimir Putin actions, he's been deeply engaged in a civil war in Syria, supporting a war criminal, Assad, the dictator of that nation, invaded Ukraine. He's carved a huge chunk out of that country. Ukraine, not a NATO ally, but the next best thing. They operate alongside us, the Ukrainians, in Afghanistan and elsewhere. He puts pressure on the Baltic states. He flies Russian aircraft over NATO airspace. Yes, he is very much a danger. And oh, by the way, Russia has the only comparable strategic nuclear force to that of the United States. So, yeah, we ought to worry about Vladimir Putin, who is no friend to the United States of America.
And here's another unfair question. What do you do about Russia and Vladimir Putin?
I think you start by publicizing just how dangerous he and his regime is. And that means not giving him a pass. The previous administration had a tendency to do that, become a little too personally close between the former president and President Putin. Number two, there's a lot we can do in cyber. This is an area where Russia is expert, but we are quite good as well, at least the equal of Russia. That's an area we can engage in. Number three, most importantly, Frank, we have to continue to work this coalition of allies, partners, and friends, NATO at the top of the list. But there are many nations not part of NATO who can be part of the democracies who stand together against an authoritarian regime like Russia. So it's be aware of the challenges, use tools like cyber intelligently, and work together with allies, partners, and friends.
Let's move to China, and specifically to the South China Sea and what China is engaged in there. That's where you actually start your book, 2034, on the bridge, actually, of the USS John Paul Jones, which I mentioned to you. I've had the pleasure of sailing aboard. What is China doing in the South China Sea, and why do we need to be concerned about that?
Yeah, let me just get everyone on the same page of music in terms of geography. The South China Sea is a vast sea space. It is roughly the size of the Caribbean Sea and the Gulf of Mexico combined. China claims it as territorial waters. It would be as though the United States decided that we would simply claim territorial sovereignty over the entire Gulf of Mexico and Caribbean Sea. China is doing that over the South China Sea. And to buttress these claims, which are preposterous and have been rejected firmly by the international courts, they're building artificial islands. And they do this by dredging sand and building an island. And these are not small. These have airstrips. They have radars, tanks, troops, missiles. And China believes that by constructing these artificial islands and pushing back on the United States, which is conducting what are called freedom of navigation patrols, simply sending our warships into the region in order to demonstrate that these are international waters, high seas. They're not territorial seas. China will push back on those. I think this is the most significant potential flashpoint between the United States and China. We ought to worry about this one a great deal. That's why we begin the novel, 2034, in the South China Sea with a small flotilla of three destroyers, including the John Paul Jones.
And is solving that issue, as large as it is it through bilateral talks between the U.S. and China, or is it involving regional partners, the U.N.? How do you say to China, look, this is everyone's South China Sea, not yours?
Yeah, this is, I think, the biggest question facing the international community is not just the South China Sea, but the rise of China as a potent, aggressive global actor. And I would put South China Sea in the mix with my concerns, but it's also internal concerns within China, a genocide against the Uyghur population, the crackdown in Hong Kong, the threats to Taiwan, pushing on the border with India, bullying local neighbors all around the South China Sea, conducting shadowy attacks in cyber, stealing intellectual property. You get the idea. There's a lot of tension between the United States and China. So if the question is, what should we do about it? Mm-hmm. Number one, we should construct a strategy. The Trump administration tried a series of kind of tactical engagements. One minute, it's President Trump and President Xi having dinner together in Mar-a-Lago. The next minute, we're effectively throwing huge tariffs against China. Very episodic. What the Biden administration should do is create a strategy, and one that integrates our economic tools of power, our diplomatic tools, our military deterrence, our cultural impact, our ability to communicate. And you mentioned it already, Frank, this network of allies, partners, and friends. Construct a strategy and then go to China and say, look, we have to work this out. Confront China where we must, South China Sea, for example, but also, Frank, try and find zones of cooperation with China. Climate, preparing for the next pandemic, humanitarian operations. There are always things we can do with China, so confront where we must, cooperate where we can, have a strategy. I think that would be the right prescription.
All right. On that note, we're going to take a short break. Is NATO still relevant now that the Cold War is over? We're going to ask the former NATO Supreme Allied Commander, Admiral James Stavridis, when we come back.
The one that benefits really the least is the United States. We benefit the least. We're helping Europe.
And welcome back. We're with retired Admiral James Stavridis, the 16th Supreme Allied Commander of NATO. He's also the author of 2034, a novel of the next world war. Admiral, you heard former President Trump there. Top aides like John Kelly and John Bolton reportedly had to talk him out of withdrawing from NATO. President Trump clearly wasn't a fan. Is NATO still relevant in a post-Cold War era?
NATO is absolutely still relevant in a post-Cold War era. Let's just look at the missions NATO is conducting right now. We spoke a moment ago about Afghanistan. We're down to 2,500 U.S. troops there, but the Europeans have 8,000 troops there, almost triple what we do. So they're supporting our efforts there in Afghanistan. They are, most importantly, perhaps, a bulwark of deterrence against Russia. We spoke a moment ago about the extremely aggressive Russian behavior all around the continent. NATO is also engaged in the Arctic, engaged on the Syrian border, Turkish-Syrian border, is conducting operations on the high seas and counter-piracy, and is conducting very capably counter-cyber operations. So, yes, the alliance is still deeply relevant. Just look at the missions and what it's doing. But let me make another point, particularly to President Trump's criticisms of the alliance. It's the numbers. It's the money. President Trump would often criticize the allies for, quote, not paying their fair share. Let's kind of do the numbers for 1 second. U.S. defense budget is about $650 billion. China's defense budget is about $200 billion, about a third of the U.S. Russia's defense budget is about $80 billion. Guess how much those, quote, freeloading Europeans spend on defense? They spend over $300 billion. Collectively, the Europeans spend more than China and Russia combined. They also have extremely advanced technology. They have stood and fought with us and died with us in Afghanistan. You alluded a moment ago to U.S. casualties. While I commanded that mission, I lost 1,700 men and women under my command. I wrote a letter of condolence to every one of them. Mm. Of those letters I wrote, almost 700 went to European families. So these are allies who have fought with us. They have the second largest defense budget in the world. They have the technology, if you will. I'd say they're pretty good value for the money, in my view.
Speaking of money and defense budgets, so much of defense spending goes into technology and advancing weaponry. One of the characters, if you will, in your book is the real-life jet, the F-35. It's the Joint Strike Fighter that has been, to say the least, highly criticized here in the U.S. And I just wonder, without giving anything away in your book, you're not a fan. My sense is you're not a fan of it. How come?
The jet, the Joint Strike Fighter, F-35 Lightning, has cost too much money. It has a multiplicity of design concerns that we don't really have time to go into, but please take my stipulation of it. It is taken way too long to get to market, and it may be, in many ways, the worst procurement program that I've seen in the course of my time and career. So I worry about it. And I'll tell you another thing I worry about. It relies on kind of exquisite technology, and that's fine up to a point. But what happens when that exquisite technology fails? What's plan B? And in the novel, again, we won't give it away, but the first jet you encounter is a Joint Strike Fighter. The last jet you see toward the end of the novel is an old beat up F&A 18 Hornet. The latter is the one that comes through.
For the past few decades, American military dominance has been guaranteed by our superior technology. Is that something that we can continue to rely on in the decades ahead?
Not at all. It's pretty easy to have a dominant military technology when you're fighting the Taliban, who are up against you with late 20th century capability, or operating against terrorist groups in the Middle East or in the southern part of the Philippine Islands or the east coast of Africa. But in this emerging period of competition with China, again, the subject of 2034, we are up against a peer in every sense. And their capabilities are accelerating. And in particular, I would focus on China's drive to dominate cyber, their integration very rapidly of quantum computing and artificial intelligence into military activity, their evolution in hypersonic cruise missiles. There's one going by on the screen right now. These things fly 6 to 10 times the speed of sound, multiples higher than anything we have in our current inventory to defend against. So we've got a real challenge on our hands here that we haven't had since the height of the Cold War against the old Soviet Union. We better get ready. This is the looming tower of our times.
I just have a minute to go before the break here, but will there come a time in our lifetimes when the U.S. will have to accept that we are a secondary power to a country like China?
Not if we decide we want to continue to be the very best. And that is a decision for the nation going forward. I would say we are in danger of losing that increasingly narrow edge over China. And we better make those decisions in real time, because if not, the world of 2034 will be on us before we know it.
All right, we're going to take one final break. When we come back, will we indeed have another world war in our lifetimes? We'll ask that question when we come back. And we're back with Admiral James Stavridis. So the question that I posed before the break, sir, will we in our lifetimes engage in another world war?
Well, I'll give you the bad news and then I'll give you the good news. The bad news is it's possible. And so often, big events are things we just can't imagine. We couldn't have imagined Pearl Harbor. We couldn't have imagined 9/11. Who would have imagined a 20-year war in Afghanistan? Who could have imagined the pandemic of 2020? So is it possible that we could have a world war? Yes. If we have one, who will it be with? Almost certainly China. That's the bad news. Here's the good news, Frank. We can still avoid it. And that's why we wrote 2034, to lay out a marker that shows how terrible the consequences would be, both for the United States and for China. There's no good guys, bad guys in this novel. The villain is war. So what we need to do is imagine what a war would be like and then reverse engineer it, bring it back to the present, come up with a plan, integrate elements of U.S. national power, and avoid a war. But to do that, we have to operate from a position of strength, because that's what China respects.
Less than a minute left, but I just want to ask you, in 2016, you were on Hillary Clinton's short list to be the vice president. When President Trump was elected, he had you in for consultations. Is that something you may do on a personal basis moving forward? At some point, will we see you back in government service?
I am always at the service of my nation. I'm a centrist. I'm a registered independent. Always have been. Never been a Republican, never been a Democrat. I'm always happy to be helpful, advising. I would certainly consider another formal role if asked. And I believe in bipartisanship.
Admiral, we do thank you for your service, sir, and thank you for your time.
Thanks a lot, Frank.
Once again, the book is 2034, a novel of the next world war. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time.